Hey, good morning, good morning. Alrighty, everybody, let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to pray and then we'll jump in. Sound good? Okie dokie, let's pray. Almighty God, thank you for a cool morning. Thank you for the respite from the heat. God, thank you that we get to be together and to open up your word. Please guide our study. Be with us as you've always been with us, as you always will be with us. Lord, we're grateful, and it is in and through your son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning, folks. We've got some new people with us, which is awesome. But let's go ahead and quick recap on what we've studied so far, because we are still not out of chapter one, which is great, of the book of Acts. So can anyone tell me what we've gone up to? What have we seen so far in the book of Acts? Really one big thing. Anybody? So we had Luke's introduction to Theophilus, right? Lover of God, or God's love. And then we had the teaching about the kingdom of heaven for 40 days, right? And maybe 40 full days, maybe not, just a good little bit of time for something to become normal. And then we had a big thing that happened called the... There it is, thank you. The Ascension. Yes, the Ascension, wherein Jesus went up. And we had the two white-robed figures saying, what are you doing? We got other stuff going on. We can't just sit here. And we had a great conversation last week about why it is important that we can't just sit in these meaningful moments and these great, beautiful things that happen, that where there is more work to do. And then we get to Matthias chosen to replace Jesus. We're in Acts chapter 1, verse 12 through 14. Oh, and then the other thing. We are looking at our structure that we have set up for the book of Acts is we're looking at it a lot like a symphony. Right? And so because the book of Acts really gets to show us what's called the multivocality of Scripture, so it's a lot of different voices coming together to make one story, we're seeing it like a symphony where there are lots of instruments used to make one thing. And right now we're in the prelude. The prelude is in a symphony the thing that sets up so many of the themes that will come back around in the first, second, third movement. And so the prelude, You Will Be My Witnesses, we're looking at Acts 1:8 as our kind of programmatic thesis. So this is what's setting up our structure of the book. So you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And so prelude here, and then our first movement is Jerusalem and Judea. Second movement is Samaria. Third movement is to the ends of the earth. And we'll have an interlude, Acts 15, around the Jerusalem Council. And then a postlude to kind of take us all out of the book in 27, 28. So that's where we are. Any questions before we get started? I want to make sure that we're all feeling like we're caught up to speed. All good? Okay, excellent. So, Acts chapter 1, 12 through 14. Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James, with certain women. We are currently in the upper room, potentially the same upper room, that was the place where the Last Supper was held before Jesus' crucifixion. This was some reading I did this week. It was saying that this is likely a place that only kind of the wealthy upper crust had access to. And so these certain women, we discussed a little bit last week how these were likely the same women who were with Jesus from his entire ministry, who likely bankrolled his whole ministry. And these we see in Luke 8, who were Mary called Magdalene, Joanna, the wife of Herod Stewart, Chuza, and Susanna. And so these were sometimes wealthy women who were able to help fund this. So we've got our 11 disciples. We are understanding that we are missing one, right? And we are missing one who is Judas himself. Matthias chosen to replace Judas. So we are in verse 15. Does anyone want to read this so that it's not just me talking up here? Go for it.
In those days, Likewise, Peter stood up among the brothers and sisters, together the crowd numbered 120 persons, and said, "Brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allowed his share in this ministry. Now this man acquired a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. This became known to all the residents of Jerusalem, so that the field was called in their language, Hakeladama, that is, field of blood."
Thank you so much. Appreciate that. It was a nice rest. Before we get into what I have, what do we see here? Not even a little, clearly. Yeah. It's interesting. So one of the things that we see in a lot of first century literature is that the wicked get there, what is coming to them. And so, yeah, this whole section here where it's like, that is graphic. Why so graphic? No. So graphic because it was important for the first century readers to understand that there were real life consequences, right? They wanted, especially for people who were coming from sort of this, from the law, right? From the Jewish system. And one of the things we've talked about is Christianity was Jewish. It came out of Judaism. In this time, it was not seen as something at all separate from Judaism. It was a sect of Judaism. It's why they worshiped in the temple. It's why all these things happened there. But coming out of this, it was still sort of like, oh man, we got to have the wicked get their just desserts. We need them to actually suffer for the things that they caused. And so Judas, the one who, the reward of his wickedness, falling headlong, he burst open in the middle and all his bowels gushed out. It's a lot. So anything else we see here? Yes, it was. Yeah. I should have had a... Yeah, it was a big, it's a big spot. Like 120 is, it is what is considered the upper room today. I was able to see it when I was in Jerusalem in January. And it's not, it is probably roughly the size of this room. And so 120 people is still like, oh, it's a crowd. We got a crowd in here, you know, but it's still, so this 120, that's actually interesting. There's some Jewish traditions that say 120 people were the ones who received the Torah. And so there's some connections there. There's some parallels there. And then 120, 10 people for 12, right? The 12 disciples, the 12 tribes of Israel. There's some connections there, some parallels. I wouldn't put so much stock in it, but 120, there's something. So, anything else that we see?
They like to name the field.
Yeah.
Like, they a lot of the blood, there's some of the blood, there's
Golgotha? Yeah. The place of the skull?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They like to
put them dramatically. Yes, they do. Yeah. I don't actually know. Maybe it was because there were landmarks that everyone could see. I don't honestly know why, but we do have this. So, but we have. Let's see, what else? What did I put here? 120 persons. So this is interesting. In those days, that doesn't give us much of a time frame, right? We're coming off of the ascension. We understand in our tradition that it is 40, 50 days after the resurrection, so it could be any time then. But in those days, nonspecific, Peter stood up among them, 120 persons. Peter shows up as the spokesperson for the group and speaks following Jesus' command to him. So if we look back in Luke, the end of Luke, we see him say, "But I have prayed for you that your own faith may not fail, but you, once you have turned back, strengthen your brothers." So this was before Peter's betrayal and his denouncement of Christ three times. And Jesus, knowing this was going to happen, it's almost became a proving ground of faith. So once this happened, he actually took up his mantle as the spokesperson. He became the one who would strengthen his brothers. And he stood up and he spoke what he said. So, and then the 120 shows that this community was already quite strong and beyond Jesus' immediate circle. So it's easy to think in, when we read the Gospels, that the 12 were just the folks who were, those were the only people that Jesus was with. And to some extent, yes, but there was a large following around Jesus already. The 12 were just sort of the inner circle. And then there was the three, then there was the beloved disciple, right? And so they're radiating out. We have this huge group of people who were already following Jesus. And then the scripture had to be fulfilled. So this is interesting. So we talked about how one of the big themes in the book of Acts was the crucifixion, right? And how Peter will interpret it differently than Paul, and Luke will interpret it differently than all of them kind of together, and part of this multivocality, the symphony in the scriptures. So Peter links the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus to the foretelling of scripture, which we see again and again and again when Peter's giving his speeches. So Luke 24, 26, 27, he puts that in there as well. And he also links the betrayal and death of Judas to the foretelling of scripture. Does anyone remember one of the big themes that we talked about at the beginning, where the Old Testament's showing up in Acts? It's a fulfillment of whose hopes? Anyone remember? That's totally fine. I don't expect this. It is a fulfillment of all of Israel's hopes. So one of the things that we see, he's going to quote from two different psalms coming up, and he's going to interpret them as a fulfillment of the scriptures. So to understand what's going on in Acts, we have to have a good understanding, either ourselves or that they had a great and really kind of total understanding of the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, what we call it. And to understand that they see the things that are happening as relating back to and fulfilling what has come before in their scriptures. So we've got two psalms that are going to come up. And that also brings us to the theme of God's sovereignty versus the free choice of man. If he links the betrayal and death of Judas to the foretelling in scripture, how is this Judas's free choice, right? And that's a question that is tough to deal with, honestly. And I think we talked about it a little bit, but I personally subscribe to, and I think that the book of Acts really does do a good job of putting forth this idea of non-competition between the will of God and the choice of man, that somehow, some way, they are linked together, but they are, one is not necessarily dependent on the other, if that makes sense. And we will come to that more when we get to Acts 2. So verse 19, Hekeldama, that is field of blood. Matthew and Luke both associate Judas. We can see it in Luke. He does already talk about the field of blood, and they both identify it as the field of blood. This is where it gets really kind of interesting. So Hekeldama is an Aramaic phrase. Do we remember what language the original Acts was written in? It was Greek, yes. So he uses an Aramaic word, something completely different, and he's translating for his Greek-speaking audience. So we talked about a little bit how this was written to a people who could read Greek, right? Or at least had an understanding of it. So he's writing to a group of people who were likely not already Jewish. Not saying that they weren't. There were lots of learned and educated Jewish people who could read and speak Greek, but the spoken language was Aramaic, right? And so that gives us a pretty good clue as to who, it's what we call an intertextual clue, as to who this was written for and to, which is a group of Greek-speaking people. There it is. So this is from Jerusalem. This is so fun. I was very glad that I got to bring this up. So this is what's interesting. This is Jerusalem. This is facing the West Bank. In Jerusalem. I took this while we were standing at the place where it is pretty commonly thought, I forget what the name of the church is, but it's the place where Peter is thought to have denied Jesus and where the cock crowed three times. And over here, you can see this is the field of blood. This is the place wherein Judas bought the land and died. And then we're going to zoom in. This is, it's a series of tombs and caves that have been set up since then. But there's also, and I don't think I added a picture, but over here, if it were zoomed out, there's actually a monastery here that is set up near the field of blood. But this was the place, and I think it's sort of interesting, and I don't know if it has any real meaning, but thematically, that you can see the field of blood from the place where Peter denied. What do y'all think about that? Like, that you, I'm standing where I took this picture, in the place where Peter denied, right? Where Peter denied Jesus three times, and then the cock crowed, and he understood, oh no, I messed up. And from that place, and granted, Jerusalem's a small city, right? And so you can see a lot of places from a lot of places. But I think it's interesting thematically that you can see the place where, like, the, what is this, what does it say? The reward of Judas's wickedness.
The wages of sin is death.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that that's interesting that you can see the place where Peter betrayed. Or you can see the place where Judas betrayed from the place where Peter denied. And it's almost like you see two different, there are two sides of two options, two stories of people who did deny, and two stories of what could happen. You could either have the church built in your memory or a series of tombs and the field of blood. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Truly. That's really great. Yeah. Oh, 4,000 or 5,000 years old, at least. Like, truly, you can see that some people will live there. Like, there's refugees and stuff who will sometimes encamp there, but it's no one has developed this. Like, this is still just what it is. And you can see there's, like, water jugs and stuff down here. But that's, it's a place where people who have nowhere to go, nowhere else to go, will go. But I think it is interesting that there's that no one has developed. Jerusalem?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. I mean, that's one of the things where often when they say they'll go up to something or somewhere, it can mean north, but it can also just mean physically up. and it's, yeah, it is incredibly, incredibly hilly. And Jerusalem was is built on this hill. And so, like, there's you can drive all around the old city. And you can see the Western Wall. You can see all of these things that are just in Jerusalem. And so it's actually, if we go back, like, I'm here, standing on top, down into a valley, up to the field of blood. And, yeah, it's a very, very hilly place. But I really love the everything's so close together. It's a really fine line that can be walked, right? Very lovely. Good reflection. Anybody else see anything? We are at verse 20. Can someone go ahead and read verse 20 for me? Yes.
For it is written in the book of Psalms, let the house become desolate, and no one. And let another take his
place. Yes. So that's verse 20, and we are still talking about Judas, right? Hakaldama comes right before this. So we see that Peter's allusions to the book, to the Psalms, come from Psalm 69:25 and 109, verse 8. And did I put them up here? Well, he uses the LXX, or the Septuagint. So let's get into it. The Septuagint is, does anyone know what the Septuagint is before I do this? So it was the Greek version of the Hebrew Bible. It was, and it was composed and kind of put together in this intertestamental period. So after the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, we have 400 years of silence, right? 400 years of silence. And then that's called the intertestamental period. And that's when we have really no record in the canonical books. There's in the Apocrypha, there's stuff, but then we get to Mark and the Gospels. So in this 400 years between the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Hebrew Bible and the Christian Bible, we end up with a translation of the Hebrew Bible called the Septuagint, or the LXX, because as tradition goes, LXX 70, right? 70 people did the translating, did the receiving of that. Another intertextual clue is to the audience for Acts. A lot of times in the New Testament, when they're quoting the Old Testament, they'll do it from the Septuagint. They'll do it from the Greek. And so another intertextual clue is to the audience. Now, this is what's interesting. We often see the Psalms as poetry, right? Because they are. But Peter seems to be interpreting this as a form of prophecy, right? As a form of, let his house become desolate and let there be no one to live in it. Let another person take his position of overseer. What do we do when we see parts of the Bible seeming to use other parts of the Bible that seem to be taking it out of context, right? Because contextually speaking, we talked a ton about context before we started this, right? About how you have to understand the genre, about how you have to really understand what's going on, to interpret it by its own rules, to do all these things. When Peter takes what is always understood, even by them, as poetry and interprets it as a form of prophecy or a fulfillment, yes? Mm-hmm. Interesting. I like that take.
It's easy to remember.
Yes. No, truly, yeah. Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
People are still doing NFL 2,000 years.
Yeah. Yes.
Peter's just starting something
else. I like that. Yes.
And I think there's something about, like, they prayed the Psalms all the time.
Yes.
Right? It was part of the liturgy. And so perhaps there was a sense of resonance. Mm-hmm. And so when they were processing and praying what was going on, those words might just
absolutely
naturally bubble up.
Yeah, and I think that goes back. Absolutely. I think that goes back to what Thomas was saying as well, that it's easy to remember. And because, like we talk about in our liturgy, right, that we pray not only with our lips, but with our very lives, that that the liturgy, we don't just do the liturgy. The liturgy changes us. And it, like, when it, you know that when you've been here long enough, you know what's coming, right, in the liturgy. And there are some times where, like, words of the liturgy will come to you unbidden, and you're like, well, what is that about? Like, I wasn't thinking about this, and somehow it does have something to do with what's going on. When you dwell with something long enough, it does get deep into your bones, and you start to process that stuff through the stuff that's already in your head. And it's easy to remember because it is poetry. It's easy to remember, and it's already, because it was an oral tradition, right? People had long portions. When we get to Paul, we'll understand that he had so much of the Hebrew Bible memorized because it was an oral tradition. And because this was, let his house become desolate, let there be no one to live in it, he sees that. He sees what happened with Judas, and he says, okay, well, that sounds like this thing that I already know. That sounds like Psalm 69 or whatever it was at the time. And let another take his position of overseer sounds like Psalm 109. This is just what it is. It's part of this deeply ingrained thing. And so when it does come to, is he quoting this out of context? Maybe by our rules. But again, we do it, and I agree with you, but I don't take such a cynical view that people have been doing this forever, even though they have. But it's part of what it means to be someone who is deeply entrenched in the Bible, in the scriptures, in the liturgies, right? Yes. Exactly. Yes, it is. And he is the spokesperson for the community, right? So it's them seeing this stuff together, and at the same time, you were going to say something? Yeah. Oh, interesting. Yeah.
I don't know
Yeah.
They would isolate that to keep it from catching.
Yeah. Yeah. And it might be some of that too, like needing to, at some level, justify what was going on, right? And having that available. So it could be all of these things. But I think what comes, my view and interpretation is that this was just so deeply ingrained into who Peter was, into who the community was, that there was an understanding of what he was doing. Like, he didn't have to say, now, everybody, if you look at Psalm 69, verse 25, you'll see what I'm saying. They knew what he was doing. They knew where he was going. They knew everything about it. So that is verse 20. Can anyone read 21 through 26 for me? You got it.
Peter, the one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day he was taken up from us. One of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection. So they proposed two, Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. When they prayed and said, Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias and was added to the 11 apostles.
Thank you so much. What do we see before we move into it? What'd you say? A little. A little crapshoot? Yeah, truly.
I prayed
for
those guys to come up. Yeah. No, that's not the only time that's ever.
Yes. What were you going to say, Tom?
So, I'm not sure what they mean by so one of the men who are coming.
Yeah.
Are they talking about Judas? The guy who was with us all this time, we need to replace him, and they're sad about it? Or are they saying that other two men who've been with us and like apostles.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I'm interpreting it, but yeah. I'm not sure.
I think that that's what it's saying, is that one of the requirements for whoever is going to fill the apostleship had to be someone who was with them the whole time,
okay.
Which again shows us how big the community already was, that it wasn't just, you know, 13 dudes trekking across, you know, the ancient Near East. There was a large group. Yes. So it is, there's some clues as to that based on their names, which we'll get to in a minute. And it might be, like, Luke is a master storyteller. We'll see over and again that he's so good at what he's doing. But I wouldn't put so much stock in the meanings behind their names, because that just kind of moves them down the rung from canonical importance to just literary devices, right? And we talked about how we're going to interpret this. We're using the canonical lens, not singularly the literary lens, right? But we do have some clues in there, and we'll get to that in a second. Anything else?
First time I read that, he has so many different names. I thought it
was, yeah.
Joseph was also Matthias. I didn't realize it was two different guys.
Oh yeah, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus or Eustace. It's like,
oh,
that's
man,
yeah,
Matthias.
Yeah. He's got one name. Yeah, Matthias. I know.
Didn't most people, or not most, but some people have a Hebrew name and then a Latin.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we have Simon Peter, who is also called Cephas. Like, he's got three names. We've got Joseph called Barsabbas, who's also Eustace. He's got three names. And then we have Matthias, who's got the one.
And I always feel sorry for Justus.
Yeah.
He's never mentioned again. He's done
now. Everybody prayed and
yeah. Yeah. And then he's not really heard from again at all in the scriptures. Yeah.
Is that it says fellowship one of these two you have chosen to take the place of this ministry.
Yes.
Like, it's not saying that the other guy doesn't have a ministry.
Yes. Yes,
it's
yes, yes.
This
particular yes. Ministry. Yes. Oh, I love that. Yes. This is, and one of the things I really, and this is part of what we're gonna get to, but you know what, we're talking about it. So I have like his own place, right? Italicized. And so, which one you have to take the place? Luke is playing with this idea of place, right? This is the same word. He's using it different ways, right? Judas's own place was Hakeldama, the field of blood, but we're using to take the place in this ministry to mean a role as well. So he's doing this very interesting literary thing where he's using the same word to mean two different things, and it does get us to the point of like, okay, so this is all about role, not about necessarily character or identity, or that one person is over and against another, which what does that sound like, by the way? But that there are different roles, different places for people. It's not that one thing is better than the other. It's simply that this ministry is for another, which does sound a whole lot like what we've got going on, right? Yes?
Well, I also always read the cast lots as I'm more on the negative side of he got the short straw. These guys
interesting.
Live well. I mean, their life goes on.
Yeah.
But almost every one of those 12
yeah.
ends up with a horrible death.
Yes.
So,
yeah. That's pretty fair, actually. I've never thought about that. They actually, the way that lots were cast was it was basically, it was sort of short straw, like a bunch of stones, differently colored and shaped stones, were put into effectively a hat or a bowl, and you threw them out, whatever came. Yeah.
This is only the second time I've ever heard of that.
Uh-huh. It was a fairly common way of doing things in terms of, like, the first century.
Well, the only time we heard about it in the Bible is really bad, you know.
Yeah, so what is that? Yeah, okay, let's do that. Let's put that together. What does that tell us about this? I think you're right, Bob, that maybe this was like, oh, shoot. Oh, no, nobody should want this. Yeah, I mean... In James, actually, that's a really great point. One of the offices of the apostleship was teaching, right? That was a big part of the apostleship. It was healing, it was teaching, it was all of these things. But James, in chapter 2 or 3 in the book of James, which was arguably one of the first books written and might have been written sometime around this time, says that like teachers will be judged more harshly. And so, like, it really was not the best thing in the world to be like, oh, man, okay, yeah, let me go ahead and take on this mantle. And being raised up, it's also, they proposed too. Like, Joseph, and or Eustace and Matthias, they didn't put themselves forward. The community was like, what about these boys? Like, you know? Yeah, they were voluntold. And... Yes. Yeah. Yeah, a bit of a sentence, actually. But we talked about, yeah, so the requirement seems to be twofold, a man, likely a cultural thing, something to represent the 12 tribes, right? That was, and accompanied us. So again, we talked about there were more than 12 who were there. I already asked this question. What does this remind us of? A group of people who are following Jesus with the same fervor and tenacity, say a church, but there are some who are set aside for specific ministry. We've got clergy people. We've got the altar guild. I'm not a part of the altar guild. I couldn't do it. I'm not nearly good at folding. I'm not that guy. I can't be part of the flower guild. These are specific ministries that people are set aside for. I think we in the Episcopal Church tend to like hierarchy a whole lot. And for good reason, sometimes it can be helpful to have that set of structure, but attaching a value to it, I think we've already talked about how maybe that's not our best move. That like there really are, you get voluntold, you get put forth by the community, whether you like it or not, and that's changed some, right? Like I had to put myself forward for discernment. I had to go and talk to my priest in LaGrange, Texas, when I don't know, 5, 6 years ago, to be like, hey, I think maybe this is something. And he was like, okay, but we do the same thing. Like in our church, what does anyone know what the process by which one becomes a clergy person is called at the very start?
Discernment.
Yeah. It's a communal thing. Like I could not by myself decide. I could have decided to just go to seminary. I could have decided to get my degree. I could have decided all that stuff, but I would never have been ordained just by my own choice and my own choosing. It takes a community to do this. It takes a community. I mean, we're baptizing someone this morning, right? It takes a community to baptize. Like it has to be done in community because you're moving from a community to a community. You're becoming a part of God's family. This is what it is. This is the whole thing where, yes, there is a form of hierarchy, but it's not really a value judgment, or it ought not be. And that's a problem we've seen a lot in church history, where we have clericalism. We have lots of people who think that they're better than simply because they have a collar. And it's not reality. That's not the reality we see in the scriptures. It seems to be truly a sentence when someone is put forth. Yeah. Yikes, right? Interesting.
When you believe that the hierarchy is justly set.
Yeah.
And when you trust the people
yeah.
in the hierarchy, mm-hmm. because then it's on voluntold.
Yeah.
Asking to participate, you're being asked to participate.
Yeah.
But when you don't trust, then you're being voluntold.
Yeah.
Because you're
that's a good way of looking at that.
Want to do it because you don't
yeah.
trust the people you're working with. Maybe pressure puts you in the position
yeah.
that now you're voluntold. Whereas you trust the people you're
yeah.
want me to work with
yeah.
you. Okay, yeah, sure. Okay,
yeah. I mean, that's part of the, I mean, I got placed here, right? I'm in my curacy. I had never spent any time in Fort Worth. I'd never been to Fort Worth. I had only ever lived in Houston. And I got told by the bishop to come here. And I trust the bishop. I trust the hierarchy.
My lot was cast
in Keller, baby. That's what it is. Yeah, exactly. And so there is that. It's not necessarily voluntold. I really like this perspective very much because it sounds very much like, all right, let me walk to the gallows. But it's not necessarily that. It's like, you know what? No, I trust that there really is. And that's part of when we get to the casting lots thing, the will of God and the freedom of man. So the casting lots seems to be left up to fate, right? But if you trust that there is a sovereign God who is overseeing everything, every bit of our lives, of course God has a plan. Of course God was sovereign in choosing Matthias over Eustace for whatever reason. We're not super duper told, but we do know that it happened, right? And I really like this perspective because it is a true trust in the sovereignty of God, even with this kind of casting lots, leaving it up to fate. Harry. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
That's what you're trusting.
Oh, absolutely. And there are times when people don't trust that. And I'm sure that we've heard stories of like, oh man, the bishop did not do what I thought the bishop was going to do. And maybe it turned out better. Maybe it turned out much worse. But that's the problem with, you know, human systems and stuff. It's always going to be something like that. We are close to time. And hey, ladies and gentlemen, we got through Acts chapter 1. Yay! We did it. We did it. We did it. There's some stuff here. If you want to read it, we are out of time. But next week, we will start in chapter 2. I'll have some of these scripture stuff written out on the tables for us. And we will see y'all next week. We did it.